Cool. So we will continue with statistical learning. Today, what is on? Today is K nearest neighbors. What I want to do is linear regression and K nearest neighbors are the two most basic models. Understanding both of these models deeply will help us understand any other model that comes in the future. So I want to first introduce K nearest neighbor, and I want to reason when to use what, when to use K nearest neighbor, when to use linear regression, and what is better in which scenario. And to be able to reason about such things, we would need a lot of mathematics. And this comes under what is called statistical decision theory. So we will develop statistical decision theory, which will then allow us to reason about k-nearest neighbors versus linear regressions. Okay, and so just like last class, start with machine learning, pose a question. We are not able to answer this question because we don't know the math, and then get into the math. Okay, so I'm sure everybody knows this k-nearest neighbor algorithm. Basically, what you're going to do is, when you want to predict y given x, you first come up with a way to find the k nearest neighbors. This function nk of x gives you the k nearest neighbors, which are closest to x. So for every x, you find its nearest neighbors. That x in the sample would correspond to a y. You just add up those y's and take an average of it. So this k and this k is the same. Okay, so when you are posed the question, so let's say you have a data set of, this is your sample, say TV and sales, right? Your sample looks like this. Something. Okay, this is your X, this is your Y. Now, when I pose the question, let's say x is equal to 94.6. Given x is equal to 94.6, what is y? The k nearest algorithm tells you, for this x, what are the closest neighbors to this? The sample is very simple, it has only two. So the two closest ones are this. Now, what are the y's that correspond to this, that correspond to these x's, that is 69.4 and 32.1. Take the average of it. Divided by 2, and this will be your new y. So the basic intuition is that when you see a new x, you try to figure out all the x's that are closest to this and take the average of y. Intuitively, all that sounds very logical. And as it turns out, this is also a very, very efficient algorithm, but in certain cases. And to be able to reason in which cases is it efficient, which cases it is not, we need to still build on a lot more theory. But this is like the most intuitive way of doing machine learning. Given a new x, figure out what are the closest x's to the current x, their y values, average it out. And if I have to do this pictorially, it's important to start writing this graph now, because it will help us later. This, on your y-axis you have sales, on your x-axis you have like say TV investment, and your data looks something like this. Okay, now given this X, what you do is you probably take these values. For these values, this was your Y1 and say this was your Y2. Your predicted Y is going to be Y1 plus Y2 divided by 2. You just take the nearest values and you average it out and you're done. This is also much simpler than linear regression. Linear regression, you had to figure out one whole coefficients matrix beta. You had to find intercepts, you had to find slopes. Then we learned central limit theorem and all of that and saw how much sample size to take. And we were able to reason about it. Here, the only model parameter seems to be k. There is nothing else to reason about. Right? So a much simpler model.
Three in this case. You have to take three nearest to.
Three nearest neighbors. And there are many ways to quantify this near Euclidean distance, Mahalanobis distance.
That will be like kind of Kernel 2.
Correct. So that this is something that we all understand, right? And this is one example of it, right? So I've taken the same sample 3 times. In this, I've taken the k to be 1. So if you look closely the line, it is all squiggly. And if I take k to be 5, the line gets a little smoother. And if I take k to be 15, it is even more smoother. I wanted to put this up because this whole thing of overfitting came up last class. And you can overfit something even though you have the same sample size. But you are overfitting because you messed up a model parameter, that is the k value. When you have k is equal to 1, that is clearly an overfit. As you increase k, you get a better fit. So overfit usually doesn't have anything to do with the sample size, it has to do with the model parameters that you're playing. Cool. So the next thing that I wanted to talk about was bias versus variance.
Okay, for this, I have just one question.
Yeah.
What if the whole way of getting into the correct model is nothing but varying the parameters, correct?
Correct.
So now, this has to be done by trial and error or, so for example, k value. How do I know that for this k value it's a correct?
It's correct, right? You need a mathematical way of saying how to pick a k value.
Correct.
We don't know enough maths yet. We'll keep that question aside for now.
Okay.
Once we learn more statistical decision theory, we will be able to mathematically say this is my k value.
Okay.
And the next concept that I wanted to introduce, which we didn't talk about last time, is bias versus variance. So going back to the linear model that we learned last time, this is a comparison of the linear model and the k-nearest neighbor model. Both are doing regression. This is linear regression, this is k-nearest neighbor regression. So there are two main concepts in statistics which you would use whenever you are picking a model. Bias versus variance. Bias basically tells you what was the error after you fit a model. Variance tells you how much does your fit vary based on the sample that you take. If you keep taking new samples, will your fit vary or will it remain kind of the same? So if you look at the linear model, I have taken 5 different samples from the same population, right? Sample size of 100. If you look at the line, it's kind of the same, even though the sample is changing. So the variance is quite low, right? But the bias, which is the error in your fit. So the error would be the distance between each point to the line. If you were to add that up, that is quite high. So the linear model has high bias, but low variance. And if we look at the k nearest neighbors, it is all squiggly, this line. So the distance between the points and the line is quite less. So the bias is low. But if the line from here to here to here to there is very different. So as you change your sample, your fit is varying. So hence variance is happening. So linear, so the k nearest neighbor is a model where bias is low but variance is high. And the linear model is a model where bias is high but variance is less. And that is how it is going to be with all models. There will always be an inverse relationship between bias and variance. The more bias you have, the less variance. The less variance you have, the more bias.
Both are inversely proportional.
Both are almost always inversely proportional. It's a trade-off. So if your given problem asks you for less variance, go for the linear model. But if your given problem asks you for less bias, then you go for k nearest neighbor.
No, but in what situations would you use low error versus low variance?
Correct. So it depends on the prediction that you want to make, right? Like, if you think that your sample is very representative, then you would want to reduce the bias. But if you think your sample is not representative, then you want to reduce the variance. Okay, so that is one way of thinking about it. And once we build more, so now the question is, like this k, at least with what we know till now, this k nearest neighbor seems to have really low bias, right? And you're getting a very irregular fit with no fancy formula. You're not using some quadratic equation, you're not solving for some complicated model parameters, nothing. You're just using basic logic and you're getting them. And you're still getting a bias which is lower than the linear model. So why would you ever use the linear model? And we don't know enough math to answer that yet. Okay, but it seems like something that comes out of very simple intuition is performing better than some complicated model. So why use a complicated model at all? To be able to answer that, we will need to learn statistical decision theory. And then we will get to answering that question. So the math that we need to learn to answer questions like the one that he asked, how do I choose k? And why would we ever use something other than k nearest neighbor? And it's such a simple algorithm and has a low bias as well. So to do that, we need to learn, let me write it on this corner and keep it here. So statistical decision theory, right? But to learn this, we would need to do joint probability distribution, marginal probability, conditional probability, random variables, and conditional expectation of random variables. We have to learn all of this, which will allow us to learn statistical decision theory. Once we learn statistical decision theory, it's only then we can formally, mathematically answer the two questions. So the two questions are, one, how to choose k? And the second question is, when not to use k nearest neighbor. Keep this to the side, so it is a good guide for where we are heading. Okay, so let's keep all of this aside and let's do some pure math. What is joint probability distribution? If you guys know, let me go through it again, because it's important to get the basics. Let's take an example of, let's say there are TV shows like Game of Thrones, Westworld, and other, right? And there are males and females. Say there are 80, 120, 125, 50, 125, this adds up to 230, this adds up to 270, 200, 125, 175, 500. So let's say there are two variables, TV shows and gender. The variable gender here is taking two values, male and female. The variable TV show is taking three values, Game of Thrones, Westworld, and others. Okay? The number of people who watch, who are male and watch Game of Thrones is 80. Blah, blah, blah. Now this can be written as a probability distribution. All I did was, I divided every value by 500 and I got a probability distribution. These six cells is nothing but the joint probability distribution. Okay, so the joint probability says, what is the probability of a person being male and watching Game of Thrones is 0.16. the probability of a person being female and watching Westworld is 0.05. Now this whole, every probability distribution needs to add to 1. Right, and if you add up these 6 cells, it will add up to 1. So joint probability distribution just is represented by these 6 cells. The integral or summation of it will give you 1. Marginal probability distribution is called marginal because it's found in the margins here, quite literally. And this distribution again adds to 1. This distribution also adds to 1. This is the distribution of gender. What is the probability of getting male? 0.46. Probability of getting female? 0.5. This is the probability of game show. Sorry, of show. The probability of Game of Thrones is 0.5. Probability of Westworld is 0.25. Right? So, cool. So, from our list, we can now, joint probability distribution is over, marginal probability is also over. And they are quite simple and intuitive. Before we get into condition. MP and
JPD, that is fine.
Right? Joint probability distribution. Yeah. Marginal probability are the margins. This one and this one.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right. So this is probability of male, probability of female.
So, or,
so any given person will be either male or female. Mm-hmm. So that is 1.
Mm-hmm.
Probability of Game of Thrones, 0.4.
Mm-hmm.
Probability of Westworld, 0.25.
Mm-hmm.
Probability of other TV shows, 0.3. Any TV show will be one of these three.
Okay.
So and hence, it is again 1.
Yeah.
Okay.
So male and female would be a feature of the sample.
Are the values a random variable is taken.
So
there are two features. One feature is show, another feature is gender. The gender variable is taking 2 values. Show variable is taking 3 values. Okay, let's just deal with one before we get into conditional probability. Let's ask a simple one. What is the probability of female or let's say female one, okay, example I have is Game of Thrones. How do I go about reasoning this?
And.
No, or. Oh, sorry, I put and. I want or. So and is simple. And is just this.
Yeah, and.
Yeah. Probability of female or Game of Thrones?
0.4.
Which one?
0.4
is probability of Game of Thrones.
Okay.
0.4 plus 0.4. Okay. So, what you are doing is you are trying probability of female. So you are taking this whole column.
Yeah.
Then probability of Game of Thrones. So you are taking this whole column, right? But what happened was your 0.24 got added once here and got added once here. So you can do 0.54 plus 0.4
minus
0.24. Makes sense, right? So that is probability of F. Plus probability of Game of Thrones minus probability of F and Game of Thrones. So all this is very intuitive. You can just look at a table and understand everything. Now another question is, now the next one is conditional probability. I can write probability of F and Game of Thrones, which I can easily look up here, but I can write it as, let's say female happens first, right? So what is the probability of female first and probability of Game of Thrones given female?
It's the same as just because they're independent, right?
Yeah, if they were to be independent,
then it would just be the product.
It would just be the product.
Yeah.
But if they're not independent, then your conditional probability is Game of Thrones given female is given by probability of F and GOT divided by probability of F. And this is a very intuitive way of thinking about conditional probability. Right? Now, the thing is a conditional probability distribution. What would be the conditional probability distribution of, let's say, shows given female? Right? So the conditional probability of shows given female is probability of Game of Thrones given female, probability of Westworld given female, probability of others given female. And that is again another conditional probability which you can calculate using this formula. That is because it is a distribution, that is again something that will add up to 1. The same way you can reason, sir, you can flip it. The probability of male given, or let me flip this, probability of female given Game of Thrones. So probability of female given Game of Thrones. So that is flipped. You will again get another. So then.
So how many women are watching Game of Thrones?
The probability. So then your distribution would be probability of male given Game of Thrones, probability of female given Game of Thrones.
That would add up to 1.
That would add up to 1. Okay, so your variable is changing. Here the gender variable changed, but show variable was kept constant. Here the show variable changed, but the gender variable was kept constant. And in both cases, the distributions will add up to 1. If you actually do the calculations, it will always add up to 1.
So essentially, that is you are restricting the population to only females, and here you are restricting the population only to
Game of Thrones. Correct. Okay, but we are able to see how what we learned with random variables is kind of again showing up here. Right, and to round up this discussion, we finished this as well. Now to round up this discussion, we know what a random variable is from last class. What we need for statistical decision theory is, we also know that the expected value of a random variable x is nothing but the mean or the average, which is nothing but a summation of the value of x into the probability of x. Correct? The conditional expectation or the conditional mean, conditional average of a random variable is, what is the conditional expectation of y given x? So if you have two random variables y and x which take all these values, then this is given by the summation of y into the conditional probability of y given x. Okay.
When we talk about this, and we say, for example, the example that you had in the thing where you shoot a basketball, neither you make it or not, or you don't. So you have to map each of those scenarios to a particular value and use that as x.
X, correct. Then you will have another, think of another random variable which has another one. So in our case, TV is one random variable, sales is another random variable. So the real world process of investing money in TV advertising is mapped to a value by the random variable TV. And your other random variable is sales. Okay, so conditional probability, and we understand the conditional expectation of a random variable as well, right? In the normal expectation of a random variable, it is multiplied with the probability of x. In the conditional expectation, you're multiplying it by the conditional probability, not the plain simple probability. Okay, good. Now,
the value for y would change in the conditional probability, right?
Correct. Y is taking on different values here, but x is remaining the same.
No, so for example, if we take GOT.
Yeah, so the problem is, this is a categorical value. So your GOT into probability of GOT given female, WW into probability of WW given female, that's not making sense. But if your random variables were to be values here, then you would have computed this easily. Okay, good. Now we have the the basic math we need to start learning about statistical decision theory. We still haven't touched these two questions yet. We are nowhere close. Okay, cool. So if you want to, statistical decision theory is like the most fundamental underlying thing of entire machine learning. And what statistical decision theory tries to do is, it tries to encapsulate any model that you work with can be encapsulated in like the framework formulae that standard with that statistical decision theory gives. Right? Any model that you see in the future can be abstracted and expressed as the decision theory formula that we are going to see now, at least in supervised learning. Okay? And the entire goal of decision theory is nothing but to minimize expected loss. Also written as average. Also written as mean. Like, makes sense, right? The entire goal of machine learning is to reduce loss. And this loss is usually represented like by things like, say, a matrix like this. Let's say this is y predicted and this is y. Okay, let's say you have an email classifier. If your predicted value is spam and your actual value is spam, then your loss is
zero.
If your predicted value is ham, actual value is ham, loss is
zero.
If your predicted value is spam, but actual value is ham,
one.
You can either do one, or you can say that's a very costly mistake. So I want to penalize it. So maybe you'll make it 100. And if you classify it as spam as a ham, it's not that bad a problem. So you might make it 25. Right? So you will come up with a loss like this. And you want to minimize the expected value of this loss. And that is all statistical decision theory in one sentence. Now, this matrix is not mathematical. To have an expected value and all of that, I need a random variable. So I will need to, a random variable is nothing but a function at the end of the day. So I will need to express this as a function. Right? So now this matrix is written as a function usually called L. And this function takes two parameters, the actual value of y, the predicted value of y, and it maps it to a real number. Now your whole goal is this expected value. We used to write expected value of x. This is nothing but our x, this random variable. Your expected value of the loss is what you are trying to minimize.
Okay, so x is the loss.
No, I mean, yeah, x is the loss. So expected value of this needs to be least. Everything is making sense. It's, it's what we would expect. And as expected, there are two main kinds of these loss functions. One is a 0-1 loss function, which you guys are suggesting for the spam and ham case. Right, one loss function is like an indicator function. If y is not, if y is equal to y hat, loss is 0. Y is not equal to y hat, loss is 1. And the other one, which we saw when we did linear regression, you are just squaring the error. Now when you want to, so now we know our goal.
But this, this just means squared.
Yeah, this is squared error, nothing else. Two types of losses, either you have an indicator function like this, or you are just squaring the error. Okay, cool. With statistical decision theory, find the lowest value of your expected. Reduce your expected value is all you need to do. Now there are two scenarios in this. One scenario is you are given an X. Right? So for example, you are given an email. And you want to reduce the expected value of your loss given one particular email. Okay, that is scenario one, which is mathematically written as given x is equal to some x1 like this.
It's just one email.
Yeah, you take one email at a time. You are taking it at a time. Email 1, try to reduce my loss. Email 2, try to reduce my loss. Email 3, try to reduce my loss. So most classification models happen this way. And when you want to write it mathematically or not programmatically, this is how you would write it. And the other thing that you do, which happens most often in a regression case, it can happen in a classification case as well, is you're not looking at 1x. you're trying to fit one line for all x, right? So then it is not conditional on an x this way. So there you just do your that is how you would mathematically write that. You are doing it for all x here, there is no condition.
What do you mean by all x?
When you did linear regression, that same line, irrespective of the x, was the same line.
For the all the data points we had.
For all data points, yeah. And no matter which x you see in the future, that y is equal to mx plus c equation is the same. Right, so that is the f of x here. When you do classification, you take it point-wise.
So that keeps changing.
Your expected loss, irrespective of x, is the same for linear regression, let's say. But depending on the email, your expected loss will vary.
So the expected value, for example, would be... No, for example, the loss function would be the mean square error, for example.
Yeah, fine. Yeah. So, and which is another random variable?
Yeah, so the mean square error is the random variable for which we are trying to identify the expected value.
Correct. So now, if you start talking random variables, your y, in the most generic case, your y is one random variable, your x is another random variable, the loss function of that is another random variable. Now you are trying to find, you are trying to minimize the expected value or the mean value of the third random variable, which was derived from the first two random variables. Right? So hopefully this starts making it clear how complicated the problem is becoming. You started with two random variables, derived another random variable from it, and you're trying to reduce the expected value of that. Now let's take the first case and see mathematically how it looks. Let's take the first case where the expected value of a loss function and I want to reduce this. Okay. This can be written as, so what is the expected value of a random variable?
Probability of the
value. The summation of the value into probability. Right. So let's just this can be written as the summation of y belongs to y. The value itself, the loss of this, into the probability of y given. This is why we did the conditional expectation of a random variable. So your random variable is this, conditioned on x being equal to that, and which is nothing but the random variable has gotten carried over because of the conditional expectation. I'm multiplying it by the conditional probability. Now in the classification case, if we take the loss function to be 1, 0, 0, 1 loss function, whenever y is equal to y hat, this L becomes 0. And when y is not equal to y hat, L becomes 1. Right. So this can be written as the summation when y is not equal to y hat, all values of y were this, probability of y given x. Now every classification problem in machine learning comes down to this. You have two random variables y and x. You find a conditional probability distribution of y and x. That is all it is. Now, our problem is, you have to find the min value of this. So you have to find the arg min of E L y hat given x is equal to this. Okay. So here your x is a constant. That's not changing. Your y hat is what you're predicting. So the argument here is y. What is taking on different values is y. Just like here. Just like how you saw in the summation. So you need to pick the y that is going to make this e the least. So the argmin is
need to pick the y cap, because that is the
y cap will be predicted from y. Whatever y you pick is going to be the y cap.
The one we have identified is the y cap, and the y is the real value.
Correct, but y is the variable, right? See, if you looked at the summation, all values that y could take, conditional probability of y, right? So, all I'm saying is, this is not an argument. X is constant. Y cap is not an argument. That is again kind of predicted. The only argument here is y. So, the arg min y. Basically, what the statement is saying is, pick the value of y that will make e the least. Okay, now which value of y will make expected loss the least?
Zero.
Zero, which is when y is equal to y cap. When y needs to be equal to y cap, right? What can you say about the probability of y given x?
One.
Yeah, so the probability of y given x need to be maximum. So to make your loss minimum, you need to make this conditional probability maximum. Okay, so that is arg max of y . So the statistical decision theory says, whenever you have a classification task with your loss function as 0, 1, you theoretically, the best model is this. And this is unknown. This conditional probability distribution is unknown. Given an email, what is the probability that it will be spam? Given an email, what is the probability that it will be ham? And all your classification models are trying to model this conditional probability distribution, which is unknown, and you somehow try to approximate it.
Can you just look at an example first, because I'm not clear on the
X, Y, and all. Fine, so your task is nothing but you have x1 which is email 1, x2 which is email 2. Okay, what you need is you need a conditional probability distribution which gives you values like this is y, spam and ham. Okay. So you pick the maximum value here such that, so your predicted value is ham. Your actual value, say, let's say it is ham. Okay, so then your loss became zero. So your expected loss became zero. Given x1. Right? So you picked the max, r max of y given x so that this became minimum. Given x1. Given x2, the story is completely different. Given x2, the argmax became spam, which hopefully the email was spam, hence your loss became zero. So your expectation became the least.
So this is how you classify each email as spam.
Spam only. But what we have completely left out is how the hell did we come up with this? How did we, this is completely unknown. And the entire task of machine learning is modeling this conditional probability distribution. That is all it is.
Specifically for the statistical data.
Yeah. Okay. And the entire statistical, so this is one very abstract mathematical way of qualifying every model of yours regarding classification. Okay.
So here we are first randomly classifying few things as spam and ham and then running over to minimize the loss.
Maybe that's how you model your conditional probability. What this is completely leaving out is how you arrive at this conditional probability distribution.
Mm-hmm.
This actual conditional probability distribution, maybe nobody knows in many scenarios. If you take the example of sales and TV, the conditional probability distribution asking there is, if my sales is $76,000, what is the probability that my TV advertising budget was $230,000? It's in some real world scenarios you never know. Probably in the email case, you can come up with at least the real distribution and try to model that real distribution. In trying to model it, a lot of different models take a lot of different approaches. But the one thing to take away is every model is trying to model this conditional probability distribution. Okay, cool. So this, let's look at the other case now, where we are not worried about a single X,
okay,
but we are worried about the entire pool of X. So now, the expected value of the random variable given by the loss function, which is a function of two variables, y and f of x. Okay, it's quite a mouthful, but it's important to keep telling it out loud so it makes sense. Do that. Okay, now can somebody tell me what is the expected value of this summation of
y?
Right. Now we are pooling over all values of x. In the previous case, we were given one x. So your summation will have two things. Okay, summation of the random variable itself, which is loss of y comma f of x, okay, and into
the probability
of
the that particular mean square error, so that
sorry, probability of
should be probability of f of x.
What about y? So the previous case was a conditional probability because we were given an x.
Mm-hmm.
Now we are trying to do it for all x's.
Yeah, it's the probability of that particular loss, the entire.
Correct. So it is a joint probability of f of x comma y.
Okay.
Okay, joint probability. Right, you are not given one x, hence it became a joint probability. By looking at this conditional probability, I can write this joint probability as, how do I express this joint probability in terms of conditional probability? write it like this, right? So probability of A, and this is AND, or this is OR.
And A and B
is probability of B into probability of A given B has already occurred. So probability, yeah, and that is what I'm factoring out.
So basically Y and F of X.
Yeah, Y and F of X is given by probability of Y given F of X into probability of F of X. Okay, now what is this L? L is nothing but
loss.
Loss, which is, let's take the squared error. Okay, so now this can be written as the summation of Y minus F of X squared into probability of X, probability of X. Right? Now, and X comma Y, there are two things here. This is getting a little too icky. It's
but right, sir. Now could you explain?
This loss is nothing but the squared error. I just replaced it. Okay, now through the magic of summation, I can write it as big thing. Okay, but if you just persist a little while longer, the result would be beautiful. Now, if I take this out as another function, right, let me call it some g of x. Okay, this will come up as, let me not confuse x here, I'll call it z, some other function. So this is okay. What does this look like? This is nothing but, yeah, this is nothing but the expected value of a random variable. You are multiplying the value of the variable into probability, right? So that is the, this is, let me write this as expected value of g of z. Okay, now my original estimation thing was try to find the least value of this.
No, it's expected value of x multiplied by g of z.
Let me write it another way. The expected value of this way. Like that. This is E, so I'm just qualifying this as EX. So you can differentiate between the two expected values.
E of X is not the probability of G of Z, right? So
no, but even this is like it has X's in it. So I've just put Z there, so I don't want to confuse.
Let's say it's a function of X, right? So that,
correct.
So that you can call it like G of X.
Yeah, I can call it G of X. Okay. So now this expectation became this expectation. And how can you minimize this? You'll have to minimize this inner function. And what does this inner function have?
P of
the same conditional probability again. So whether you are doing a classification task or a regression task, the first thing that you need to do is find the conditional probability. The form for this is not as simple as the classification task, which was like R max of probability of Y given X. But you see why this is still central. So whether you are doing classification or regression, this conditional probability is what you are after. And whether it's a regression model or a classification model, all they are trying to do is model this conditional probability. If you get that modeling as close to the real world, your values will be so good. If it is farther away from the real world, your values will be bad.
But this is essentially a descriptor of f, right? The function f.
Yeah. Good. So you have. So let's take a concrete example now.
So sorry. So just to continue that. So as f changes, this expected value would change,
Good.
And you are looking for the best f to get the lowest
expected
value.
Right. Let me take a concrete example of this. To try and make more sense of this decision theory. Let me write out a task like this. Okay. And let me take this loss function as squared error. And x and y are continuous variables. They are not discrete variables. Okay. Now, what will this expectation become? If it is a discrete variable, we were doing summation. And in the continuous case, it is the integration. Right? And if you want to learn more about integration, all of that, you can look at the calculus and linear algebra videos. Right? Now, this I can write as the integral of y minus y cap square into probability of y given x, x is given with respect to y, dy. Okay, now this needs to be minimum. When will this be minimum?
When the probability
is correct. But with this function, if you were to plot this function will take the minimum value
when
the slope is zero. Okay. So if you try to differentiate this, do you guys want me to go through the whole derivation or give the final value? No?
We'll work it out.
Yeah, fine. So, what is the derivative of y minus y cap square?
2 into
y minus y cap. The rest are constants.
Shouldn't the derivative and integral get cancelled out?
But you are deriving in respect to y cap now.
As opposed to y.
Okay, so this is, I can write this as, once I factor out the terms and all of that, I can write it as 2y cap integral of conditional probability of y given x dy minus 2 times of integral of y into conditional probability of y on x dy.
You can just bring p, y, x outside. Right?
Yeah, and this is equal to 0. Okay, what can you say about this? All you are doing is you are adding up the values in a conditional probability. And all the values in a conditional probability distribution will add up to 1. So this is 1. What can you say about this?
It's y. No.
Yeah. Y into conditional probability of y, and you are adding it up. Mm-hmm. So that is the expected value of
y.
Y But it's a conditional probability. So it is a conditional expectation. And it is conditioned on x.
X being x.
Yeah. So this is the expectation of the random variable y
given x.
Given x being x. Okay. Now this 2 and 2 goes. It is 0. So 2 and 2 goes. This is 1, so this is gone. Now your y cap is nothing but this. So
you equated it to 0. Why?
Because the derivative needs to be 0.
Okay.
Only when the derivative is 0, the slope is 0. Right, so the result is so simple, right? The result is just saying, theoretically speaking, the best possible prediction will be the making the expected value of your random variable y condition on x the least. And if I have to draw this visually, let's say there is an x, let's say there is a y, and we have magically come up with this continuous distribution, conditional distribution, not continuous. And we are given an x, this is your small x. At this small x, when you were to, if you were to sample from the conditional distribution, it would probably be something like this. Okay? And what this is telling you is, you have to pick this. Right, and this will be your y hat. And this was 1x. So your f of x will be something that will pass through this point at this. And another point at that other. And this is your theoretically best estimate of f of x. Okay, I'll keep this one result. All we are trying to do is find a conditional probability distribution and find the expected value. And in machine learning, there are two kinds of models. Now the question is, how do you come up with this conditional? There are two kinds of models. A descriptive model takes the data and somehow directly comes up with this. Linear regression is one example. KNN is another example. Neural networks, SVM, everything, just take your data and try to come up with this conditional distribution. A generative model first comes up with a joint probability distribution. From this joint probability distribution, it calculates this as your naive Bayes model is one example of a generative model. So that is about decision theory. This was the most important result we got out of it. This is the most important thing that we need to model. And every model is either descriptive or generative based on its approach it's taking for generating this. Okay, cool. So now we can finally check this off.
So when we integrated and differentiated, and we said the differential should be equal to zero, you're saying the slope, you're finding the minimum.
Yeah. Still recording, no? Did I get a message or something?
Yeah.
Hmm.
1 hour later.
Okay. Okay, now we have done all the things that we needed to now start tackling the questions. Let us now see with the two models that we know, linear model and k nearest neighbor. What do they do with this? What is, we learned last class that the linear model models f of x. Let me put my notes. So we know the most optimal f of x is this. What did the linear model do? Linear model approximated it to be. This became this in the linear model. And we found beta hat to be x transpose into x inverse x times over y. If you were to substitute, right, if you were to substitute, like, you know, E is L of Y minus F of X. Right? If you want to substitute F of X to be X into beta hat, right, you can arrive at beta hat to be the way it was X transpose X into X transpose inverse. This is what your beta hat theoretically should be. Practically it will come out to be this. So you are approximating this, which you cannot find because you do not have conditional probabilities, to this. Is what linear regression is. And what k nearest neighbor is doing is, it is saying it is approximating. It is approximating this to the average of yi given xi belongs to n nearest neighbors of x. We wrote this formula at the beginning of it. How good an approximation is this, is the question. What you can theoretically prove is, as this n and k tend to infinity, meaning as the number of neighbors that you consider, and the number of, for every this consideration, the sample size increases. This one will tend to become this one. this one and this one will become equal as n and k increase. And this is how you choose the value of k, very theoretically speaking. You want n and k to increase in such a way that k by n tends to 0. In your data set, you want to choose k such that n and k increase and k divided by n becomes 0.
But then wouldn't that make k by n become 0?
Yeah. This, I myself don't know all the theory behind this. But this is how it is set up. If you set it up this way, then these two things will become equal.
So basically k tends towards n, you're saying, as both tend to infinity.
Then if, no, see, n needs to be much larger than k, so this becomes 0.0001 kind of thing. So this is tending to 0.
Okay.
Both are becoming big, but the number of samples that you get in a neighborhood is way more than the number of neighborhoods you are considering. And according to your data set, this is how you choose k, which we are now able to answer how to choose k. So then what is the, like we saw that the linear regressions f of x was a very bad approximation of this. And we are theoretically able to show that k and n, if you keep increasing your samples, is tending to the theoretically best value. So why do we have models at all? We found the theoretically best one. Why do we ever use anything other than k nearest neighbor? So the problem comes from something called the curse of dimensionality. Right? When you have, let me write some. If you have only two dimensions, if your number of dimensions that you are considering, if your x is only one, this is y, this is x. If you consider two x's, x1, x2, and y. So the neighborhood here would have been a square. The neighborhood here becomes a
cube.
So if you just consider this a cube, the length of the edge, right? The length of the edge, expected length of the edge, I'll call it E. Given P dimensions is equal to R, say your data was all of this, right? And you have some data here. R is the fraction of data you found inside your cube.
Okay.
R to the power of 1 over P. Okay? If I use this formula, if the length of this edge given 10 dimensions and the I want to see, let's say, 1% of my data in this cube. The length of this edge will be 63% of x. This cube will cover 63% of the area of your entire space
for
1% of your values with 10 dimensions.
Okay.
Okay. If you want to find just 1% of your values in 10 dimensions, you need to make a cube which covers 63% of your area.
And it becomes a moot point.
Yeah. If you are considering so much of your space, it stops becoming a local algorithm. We used to think KNN is good because it used to take local points in your space. Right? And if you wanted to take the same calculation, I want to find 10% of my values. So to find 10% of my values, the value is 80. So the cube needs to occupy 80% of my entire input space to find only 10% of the values. And another problem with this, with these cubes, is most of the values will be at the edge of your cube. You will not find them in the middle. Like I think some 70% of the values or something will be at the boundary of your cube. They are not even well within your cube. So you have all the chances, if they are in the boundary, that it will belong to some other neighborhood. Right? So which is where your KNN starts dying. And to see that,
to cover 10% of the
values in your input space,
okay,
which are in 10 dimensions, you would need to build a cube which covers 63% of your input space. So this cube would need to occupy 63% of your input space,
okay,
to find 1% of the values. One of your input space. This is your input space in your sample x1, x2, y.
No, I thought it was 1% of the input space we're talking about.
Yeah, correct. No. Yeah, so this is the fraction of values.
Okay.
So if you have 100 samples in your sample space, spread across 10 dimensions, to find one sample,
okay,
you would need to make sure, if to have 100% probability of finding one value out of 100,
okay,
your cube would need to occupy 63% of your input space. Then you can be sure there is one value.
But then if you are covering 63% of the input space, wouldn't you have 63% of the...
Not necessarily. Because there are 10 dimensions. It's spread across not one dimension, but 10 different dimensions.
Then how is it a cube?
It's a hypercube. Some 10 dimensional cube.
No, I mean, let's take this example and extrapolate for the 10 dimensions, that's fine. So, for the cube to cover 1% of the value, it will take up 63% of the space.
Of the space.
It doesn't
because it's in 10 dimensions. So, just go from 2D to 3D. Right now, this is fine. But if you add another dimension, this gets, it has more room to move around.
Right.
So you'll have to cast your net wider. And the net is becoming ridiculously big. Okay, and like if you just back this image from the statistical learning book, right, the fraction of volume, and this is the number of dimensions. So for one, the fraction of volume increases like this, right, but for 10 dimensions, look at the growth.
Oh, okay, the size of the edge is 1% of one dimension.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I got the basic idea, but still I don't understand. Even if the area increases, how is it a problem?
How is it? So,
like, why is that problem?
So, what was the key selling point of Okay, so let's take an example. How is
so the basically the number of k's has to reduce. You can't have a high number of k. That's the problem.
Correct.
Because you're covering so much with one.
Yeah. I think this question was a little more basic. So let's say my data is like this. Okay. If I asked you the value of x, what is the predicted value of x? Would you like to predict all these values, or would you like to take a prediction from this circle?
The smaller one.
So the whole point, your values that you get out of k nearest neighbor
local
is going to be helpful if you're local.
Mm.
But the problem with increasing dimensions, it is not allowing you to be local. You are going global to find just in 10 dimensional space, meaning you have 10 input features,
mm-hmm.
right? To find just 1% of the value, you needed to cover 60% of the space. So how is that represented?
So the one that you're talking about in the distance is the largest size in any particular dimension.
It's a cube, so it will have the same dimension. Yeah.
I think first class linear algebra we have implemented PCAs for handwritten digits, right?
Mm.
Similarly, if you take an example for this one using KNN,
mm.
Say we had around 784 dimensions of each image data point, okay? You know, 784 dimensions.
Mm.
Okay. So if I give an input,
mm.
say for example number 2, out of which it has to detect, out of 0 to 9,
mm.
it has to detect 2. Can you explain how does this work?
Okay, cool. Yeah, that's a good one. Let me take a simpler example, then we'll go to image.
Now this is linear.
Okay, so
this one.
So the E10 of 1 would be 100%, right? In that.
Yeah. Yeah. So here, what did I do here? This is my input.
Hmm.
This is TV. This is sales. And I've done a scatter plot of it. Okay, what I did was, now I took another, say, 50 X's. Okay, so X1 to X50. That is what this line is representing. For X1, and now this is my query. My training, I took a sample size of say 200. This is my training for X1. I found 5 neighbors. So for let me call it Q query. So for Q1, I found XI, which is 1 to 5. For Q2, I found 5 X's again, and I go on that way. Okay, now this is still X. For each of these corresponding X's, there was a Y. Now I found 5 Y's. 5 Y's. And I took the average of these 5 Y's.
Mm.
So that is how I went from Q to one value, and I plotted it as a point here. And I did it for all 50, and I got a line like this. Okay, now let us extend it to images. You have 50 query images. You have 200 training images. Each image is a bitmap. The distance to find out the 5 closest x's to a given x, that is simple. Euclidean distance. On the coordinate axis, you can very easily find the distance. Now the first question is, how will you find the distance between two images? Each image is a bitmap like this. Basically a matrix. You are trying to find the distance between these two matrices. So come up with a distance function first. Okay? Come up with 5 nearest neighbors. Each of that would map to a classification. Okay? So let's say you found 5 images. Now, and you found 5 tag values for it. So let's say it was Q1 gave you 5 images which were closest to it, which gave you, let's say, 5, 5, 5, and 6, and 5. These were the tags for the 5 images. Now you have to find the average of it. It doesn't make sense to do 5 plus 5 plus 5 plus 6 plus 5 divided by 5. You have to define an average function for yourself. The average function might be the mode of this. The mode of this is 5. So 5. And yeah.
So when you talk about in terms of actual values, so when you're talking about from 0 to 1 as the distance.
0 to 1.
On that graph, the distance it shows on the y-axis is 0 to 1, right?
Or this one. Okay.
So when you're talking about 0 to 1, that is, 1 is the largest value in a particular dimension. Is representative of the largest value.
Yeah, I have to see
dimension.
The book again.
Yeah.
And I have to check the graph again. I can let you know. But but at the end of the day, as the dimensions increases, your k nearest neighbor is going for a toss.
So in terms of the example of the images, if you have too many dimensions.
Correct. It will go for a toss. So you would first do a principal component analysis, reduce the dimensions, get it down to some 2 or 3 or something, and deal with your principal components. You try to see a given image, you can do this as well, but this will be very bad. You can just compute, find some distance function for distance between, that would be iteration 0. After that, you would try to do a principal component analysis. Instead of seeing how far is this image from another image, you see the principal components of this image are how far from the principal components of my population.
By that you mean principal features.
Principal
features that I'm using and not, and the rest I'm ignoring.
Yeah, principal component analysis, that doesn't work by ignoring a feature. It works by eigenvectors. You do a covariance matrix of x into x transpose, and you find the eigenvectors or the singular value decomposition of these. So basically what this will give you is some combination of your features. So 20% of feature 1 plus 60% of feature 2. Is your principal component.
I just took a simpler one.
Yeah,
100%.
Correct.
Couple of things and
yeah,
the rest is zero.
Yeah, yeah. So you try to see your principal component or how far from, so you can apply the distance that way. And that will give you better results. But if you were to do k nearest neighbor with 760 dimensions, with 10 dimensions only we are seeing how badly it performs. If you extend it to 760, it's gone. Okay, hopefully we are able to see that at the end of the day there wasn't a simple answer. We learned a lot only to realize that there is no simple answer. If anything we can take away, let's hope we at least take away that there is no simple answer of how to choose k and when not to use k nearest neighbor. And the entire machine learning is modeling conditional probability. Good.